With just two races to go in 2015, the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge is headed for a pair of down-to-the-wire championships. In Grand Sport, Andrew Davis and Robin Liddell in their Stevenson Camaro have the points lead and three victories, but none in the last four races. While brothers Hugh and Matt Plum have won the last two and closed within 10 points in their unmistakable Rum Bum Porsche. In the Street Tuner division, three drivers in a pair of Mazdas have traded paint and points all season. Stand by for a shootout in the Lone Star State. It's the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge from the Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas. After a long summer at North America's oldest road racing circuits, it's time for something new. Welcome to the Lone Star Le Mans, round 9 of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge from the state-of-the-art Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas. Hello again, everyone. I'm Bob Varsha, along with Calvin Fish and Justin Bell. We've got great championship stories coming your way in both Grand Sport and Street Tuner. But here's what you need to know coming in. It is hot. Temperatures in this race expected in the mid-90s with 85% humidity. These drivers are really going to earn their money, Cal.
They will, Bob. And another thing that is hot is this GS points battle. One thing's for sure, it will go down to the wire in a couple of weekends at Road Atlanta. A pivotal weekend, really, for the Stevenson Group. This is a team that has finished runner-up in the Drivers' Championship 3 years in a row. They want to go one better. They dominated the first half of this season, but in recent weekends, they've seen that points lead dwindle to almost a crucial stage. They can't afford to panic. They feel a little bit defenseless right now against the competition. All they can do is go out, try and execute, and try and keep this points gap close as we go to Road Atlanta. But JB, there's a team right now that is really putting the pressure on those guys.
And of course, that team is the number 13 Rum Bum Porsche, and they are doing everything right. They've won the last two, and let's face it, they've done it before. They know how to win a championship, and I'm also going to give full credit, Hugh and Matt Plum driving beautifully, the team executing perfectly, and of course, going into Petit Le Mans, they need as many points as they can if they've got a chance at this championship. One strategy to win this weekend.
Well, it's going to be hot on the racetrack and in the pits, and that's where you'll find our pit reporters. Let's get more on the Street Tuner class now with Texas Tough, Brian Till.
Well, thank you, Bob. In the ST Championship, there are only 3 points separating championship points leader Andrew Carbonell from teammates Chad McCombie and Stephen McAleer, but there are 9 grid positions separating them at the start of today's race, and it does not work out in Carbonell's favor. Carbonell and teammate Liam Dwyer start 12th in their number 26 Freedom Autosport Mazda, while McAleer and McCombie qualified 3rd, their 7th top 5 start of the season, in their number 5 CJ Wilson Racing Mazda. With a championship this tight, Carbonell needs to keep a cool head in today's heat and focus on finishing ahead of the 26 if he wants to find any breathing room at all going into the season finale at Road Atlanta. But that's just one of many stories up and down pit lane. Jamie Howe has more.
Well, Brian, in order for the championship contenders to earn maximum points, they're going to have to get to the front of the field. And that's where we have the spoilers in each of the two classes. In GS, it's the number 15 Mustang from Multimatic that's on the class pole with Scott Maxwell and Billy Johnson. Together, they do have 1 win and 1 additional podium, but they've had a lot of attrition and inconsistent finishes otherwise. In ST, Justin Piscitel claimed the class pole for a record 5th time this season. But this particular effort did come with a heavy heart as his girlfriend's father, Richard, passed away this past Sunday. He's dedicated this one to him. But Justin and his co-driver Christian Shimshak, they have 3 podiums and are looking for their first win here today. Guys.
Thank you very much, Jamie. Now let's have a closer look at the Circuit of the Americas with Justin.
Well, just under 3.5 miles of European-style Formula One level track. It is uphill to the start, just after the start to the first corner, about 9 different lines into there. Then you've got this amazing high-speed dynamic direction change. A little few bumps emerging over the winter down on the back side of the track. But I tell you what, it's very wide. It's wide open, Bob, and these drivers are going to get brave.
There are great sight lines all the way around this track, but every inch of it is in the bright Texas sunshine. There's our Continental Tire starting grid across the top of your screen. Scott Maxwell will start from pole in his Multimatic Mustang GT 350 RC. Yellow background means that's the Street Tuner class. You're on board with Brad Yeager in one of the 2 Nissan 370Zs that make up the second row. There's Andrew Davis. He is starting for the class-leading Stevenson Camaro team of Davis and Liddell. And there is Marine Staff Sergeant Liam Dwyer back in action after a 1-race hiatus for health issues in the number 26 Freedom Autosport Mazda MX-5. The field is split. The Grand Sport cars will start as a group, followed by a pack of street tuner machines. And with that, onto the straightaway they come. Maxwell in the Mustang, Hugh Plum in the Porsche 911. The green flag waves and we are underway here at the Circuit of the Americas.
Hugh Plum gets an excellent start there. Can he try and make the long way around into turn one? It's a hairy brake zone as one of the Stevens Camaros looks to the inside.
Yeah, many, oh, a little touch there pushes him out wide.
Oh, Nissan's going to take advantage here, I think, Justin.
Yeah, I mean, this is the place to do it. That turn one is so wide open.
Here comes the street tuner class. A little bit of a lurch there from the pole sitting car of Justin Piscitel, but he gets away to a good start in that deep maroon Alara machine.
Yeah, he had the
championship contender McCombie goes with him as well, Justin.
Yeah, it was the perfect start to get a little break, but look at the action behind him. It's six cars wide going into turn one, Cal.
Gilsinger down to the inside using the pit lane exit. We see another one of the hard machines there, right in the action.
Four, five abreast.
Well, that's what they had in mind when this track was designed. Herman Tilke, Formula One house designer, if you will, came up with this track, spanning a small valley. Here come the S's, switching back left and right.
Oh, and these Continental tires aren't quite up to temperature, even in these extreme conditions. This first lap is a little skaty there. They try and slither their way through like a snake-type ribbon of asphalt.
The track temperature is very high, ambient is very high, a little cloud cover there for the start of this race, but it is only temporary relief for these drivers. Justin Piscitel led, picking his line. Nice clean air in front of him as he winds his way back around this track. This track in one of these cars in his ST must seem awfully wide here, Calvin.
It really is, and it allows the guys to get really brave. There's a lot of runoff area around this racetrack, so despite championships being on the line, I think you're going to see guys going for it here today.
That's the top of the long back straightaway.
Been a lot of discussion this week about track limits here at Circuit of the Americas. And eventually the race directors came down with the decision, you're not allowed to shortcut the circuit in terms of going inside an apex, but on track out, track exit, use all of the asphalt that's available. And that's really changed your whole approach to these corners, Justin.
Yeah, it has less effect, the lower capacity, the lower high speed of the car, that each category. It has more effect when you're in a high prototype class than it does in this, because you've only got so much power, only so much torque to drive you out of the, you don't want to increase the length of your track. But these guys, as you can see, all the way out on the right there. But it also means you've got to come back further for the next corner. So we're going to see a lot of usage of the extra space, but within reason.
Battle up front in Grand Sport. One of the Nissans challenging. Going to take a wide line at the top of what we've taken to calling Phil Hill. Trademark turn one here
Hammond
at Circuit.
Actually had the lead there, Bob, and I think it was the Mustang making a move on him. And Hugh Plum follows him through. There's almost a little bit of trading paint there down through two and three.
You can see they get a little bit more sensible through here because you have to thread the needle if you want for the perfect line, apex to apex. But Hugh doesn't want to sort of get overtaken by the 41 Nissan. He really doesn't want Nicholas Hammond to go by because he doesn't want the Mustang to get any kind of gap on him. And Hugh, certainly we've seen it over these races. His car, not always quick straight off the restart or off the start, but once he gets going, the pace comes up very quick.
The other thing for the guys right around him, they realize there's a fierce championship battle going on essentially between the 13 and the 6 car that we ride on board with right now. So they don't want to get involved in that. They certainly want to go for a race win here today. Maybe they can use that psychology. Maybe the guys, the 13 and the 6, don't want to get into it too tough.
Calvin, I was talking to Matt Plum before the race, and that's exactly what he just said. He said, look, we need to push hard. We're 10 points back in this championship. We need to push hard, but at the same time, we need to be safe. If we can run up front and just stay in front of the 6, the championship will come to us. We don't want to risk too much, but maybe Hugh Plum didn't get that message, Jamie, because he is charged to the front.
I'm going to go back to something the guys were talking about, the high track temperature right now. It's at 103 degrees, but the way that the weather pattern has gone this weekend is they're expecting the track temperature to be up to around 120 by the time we get to the checkered flag, just because as the afternoon goes on, it gets significantly warmer outside. And talking to some of the drivers on the grid, they said there's such a discrepancy in the temperature from corner to corner even. If one quarter's in the shade, they think, oh, I've got a really good solid car underneath me, but as soon as they're back into the sun, the track is extremely slippery, so it's just a moving target.
Well, it affects everything. It certainly affects tire temperature and how they'll perform. It affects the downforce on the cars with the difference in the air thickness. And it also really affects all of your cooling, the brake cooling, the engine cooling. Everything is a factor, let alone the driver inside the cockpit.
If you have a problem, it's going to be magnified in these conditions. The human element, the mechanical element. But you can see right now in this ST class, these guys are able to hold a very consistent stint because of the weight of the car, the weight transfer, the weight balance in the car, the center of gravity. They're able to actually keep the same lap times within reason a lot longer than the more powerful, heavier GS cars. Certainly the racing indicates that they don't back off, right?
This yeah, pair this of Mazdas breaking away just a bit. Pole sitter Justin Piscitel with Chad McCombie, who's driving for C.J. Wilson, the all-star baseball pitcher who began his career here in Texas, now pitches for the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. He'll be here this weekend while he's in a bit of an injury hiatus with his Major League ball club. Across the line they come to begin another lap on a hot but otherwise beautiful day here in South Texas. We'll be back with more of the Lone Star Le Mans from Austin. Built to the highest international standards at a cost of several hundred million dollars, the Circuit of the Americas is now completing its fourth season, bringing all of the world championships on two wheels and four to Austin, Texas. It's also the site of round nine of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. I'm Bob Varsha with Calvin Fish and Justin Bell. Glad to have you with us. You watch Hugh Plum leading the overall and the Grand Sport class. Let's get you up to speed with what's happened since we left you for the commercial break. Look at the start at the top of the hill. The 13 tries the outside, but Scott Maxwell, the pole sitter, hangs on. Challenged on the left
there to the outside. He tries to make the move, makes it stick. Look at the start here in ST, Justin.
Yeah, it was a great onboard in the 26, but it gets crazy wide. You can go five, six cars wide up into that uphill section. There is no right line, Calvin.
Wow. That is awesome stuff.
Yes, it is. Scott Maxwell started on the lead. Nick Hammond eventually had a piece of it, and then Hugh Plum took over. Meanwhile, this is the number five C.J. Wilson Mazda going by our pole sitter Justin Piscitel for the lead in that class.
Yeah, Piscitel is starting to get a little bit loose there with his Mazda, but this is a move down into turn 12. Hugh Plum takes the run-bump machine to the front and takes off. He's got a four-second lead right now.
I said the 15 looks a little unwieldy at this stage of the race, and those Nissans are looking very sporty, very clean pass. He actually took two positions there. Brad Yeager came past, cleanly executed. But you know what? This is a sight you do not see very often. The number 25 Mazda absolutely puking out smoke out of the back. I don't know the last time I saw that, Bob.
That was Britt Casey Jr., car he is sharing with Tom Long, but appears their race is run, and it did not bring out a caution flag. So we continue under green since the get-go.
Chad McCombie with the lead, and the guys they are really fighting hard for in this championship. Andrew Carbonell, his teammate Liam Dwyer, sits down in the 15th spot right now. A long way to go, but I really feel today they're going to need a caution to get back into the big points.
Now, veteran race fans are looking at these cars going well off the track boundary there, and you're saying, wait a minute, you're not allowed to do that, are you? Well, as Calvin pointed out earlier, tracking off the corners, race control has told the drivers you can use all the pavement you can find.
It took the drivers, oddly enough, a lot of laps to get used to executing the free, newfound freedom that they had, because you can carry another mile or 2 miles an hour, maybe more, through the apex. So you actually have to look how far you can go out. So it's definitely taken the drivers a little while to get used to it. Right now, I'd say by the lines they're taking, they're pretty up to speed. Jamie, what was the 81 in for?
Well, I asked the crew what the problem was, and they said Texas. Then they took two jugs of water out to the car. They're having some overheating issues in that number 81.
That's early in the running here with less than 30 minutes on the board for that to be happening. So could be a long day for that Bimmerwell car.
To Brian.
Down at Rumbum, they're hoping the long day ends with a checkered flag with them up front. Matt Plum watching your brother right now. Pretty aggressive at the start. How hard do you want him to push this early on?
You know, I think
it was important for him to get clear of some traffic if he could. Obviously, we got strong competition, but the Rumbum Porsche is running great. It's been all week. This seems to be the track for us. It's slippery, it's hot. You know, having the engine in the rear is helpful, especially power down off the corners. And really, I think the key is going to be tire management. I mean, if you drive it like an axe murderer, there's going to be hell to pay later on.
He was saying earlier that the hands get busy, you start to wear tires. But as a driver in there, how do you control those tires? How do you save them a little bit, especially in this heat, other than just being calm with the wheel?
I mean, it's really just that, you know. Everybody's driving basically qualifying pace out there, but you got to take a touch off and just not overwork the fronts and not overwork the rears and drive a pace that the car gives you rather than you want the car to do. So not to give away too many secrets, but I think that's about it.
Don't be an axe murderer. That's the big secret on how to save tires down here at Rumbum, guys.
All right. Thanks, Brian. I'll make a note.
Yeah, but, you know, a nice driving lesson there from Matt about how to do this. But you're watching, you actually, the way his brother is out there driving very tidy, and he can be right now. He's actually got between half a second to three quarters of a second easy on a lap time, Calvin, if he really pushes, you know, if he keeps extending it. But I was watching the number 14, Nissan and Brad Yeager. He's actually also able to drive very within himself. We found those Nissans very very manageable in the slippery conditions. So two cars at the front of GS running very well. But here in ST, I mean, they just push all the way, don't they?
Well, Liam Dwyer there a little bit wide, but we were just trying to look. We obviously saw the sister car have some engine issues, and we're seeing a little bit of a wisp of smoke there under acceleration from the sister car right now, which is a big concern with the championship contenders. Back to the fight in Grand Sport. Well, Andrew Davis has got around Scott Maxwell, it looks like. He's moved up to the fourth spot, and that is important because as they ran on the previous time across the stripe, their championship lead of 10 points coming down would have been cut down to one with Hugh Plum running as he does out front and those guys in fifth, but Andrew's now moved it up to the fourth position.
Yeah, we caught a glimpse at Ashley Freeberg going through. She's driving very well, holding off Austin Cindric. I mean, by this point, obviously, there's an awful lot of deterioration in the handling of these cars. The heat, look at the way they use that wide line, but Cindric having a look down the inside, he is gonna touch her, guaranteed.
Yeah.
He does, he knocks her sideways. Oh, that was a little bit, you know.
Well, he tucked it in there, he wasn't completely alongside, but I think at that stage of the game, Ashley must have realized that he was gonna force the issue there, and as you said, there was gonna be contact one way or the other.
We could forecast that. There was two people running through a fence post wearing sumo outfits. You know it's not gonna go well for one of you.
Ashley did a great job in qualifying. She only got eight laps running here. It's the first time she's visited this circuit, put the car seventh on the grid. So she's learning more and more as each lap goes down in the race today.
He had a lovely wide line there on the exit. He set her up beautifully. I mean, on review, that was a nice hole shot as he coming up there, but he relied, he has to go on the inside of that curbing through the final corner. Nice opposite lock by Ashley as she controls it. Realized discretion, best part of balance coming off.
I think looking at it again, I think Ashley was just so focused on Matt Bell there. She was focused on getting a run off the final corner there. I don't think she probably realized that, you know, the car was to her inside, Austin Cindric.
Also notice that tire donut in the right-hand door. I think Ashley Freiberg's had an interesting race thus far in the Trimtex car. On board with Liam Dwyer, making a pass on the long back straightaway here at Circuit of the Americas. We'll be back with more from Austin, Texas in just a moment. Welcome back to Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas, and round nine of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge for 2015. No change up front in either the Grand Sport or Street Tuner classes. There's Hugh Plum, who grabbed the lead early, and he and his brother Matt are doing everything they need to do to try to close that 10-point gap to the series leaders, Liddell and Davis, in Grand Sport.
Right now, Bob, if that finished like it did now, and there's obviously a long way to go in this race, but they would have a 7-point cut in that point lead. It'd be down to 3 points going to Atlanta. Well, that would mean if the bump car finished, there would be nothing that Stevenson could do about it. Even if they finish second, they lose it on a tiebreaker. So this is every position right now for Andrew Davis is crucial.
There's a look at the points. And we talk about the top, the front runners in each class. But keep in mind,
down to 7th place in points in Grand Sport and 9th place in Street Tuner are still mathematically alive. So while some guys are trying to grab the lead here today, other guys are just trying to position themselves to make that lunge in the season finale at Road Atlanta.
Certainly, as we're watching everyone work their way through the traffic here and this winding, beautiful circuit here, as you say, it's the same story in both categories, Bob.
Out to the ST class. There's Chad McCombie sharing with Stephen McAleer, the Mac attack, if you will.
One thing that's a little bit different, when you're running these 2 hour, 30 minute races, you think there's gonna be a reset. So it's like, you know, don't try and extend the lead, don't use the car up. But with this racetrack, the amount of runoff, is not certain we're gonna see a caution here today. So by McCombie doing the job he's doing in building this lead and building the gap to the Liam Dwyer car that sits down in the 13th position, it's gonna be awfully tough for Andrew Carbonell to get that back just on pure pace alone.
Let's hear what the points leader in ST thinks as he watches his teammate in action, Brian.
Well, Bob, Andrew Carbonell's been kind of glued to the timing screen over there, and Andrew Calvin was just talking about it. 13th right now is where Liam sits. The 5 sits up front. Well, you're already, I can tell, thinking about strategy. What's it going to come down to when it's time to get in the car?
You know, this place, great design, very safe track, but also doesn't give us many cautions. And right now we're kind of hoping for a caution. We've lost a bit of a gap to the leaders, but we're going to work hard to bring that back. You know, the CJ cars up front are doing a great job as the LR car. You know, Mazda MX-5 is a really great car around a track like this. Only a few straightaways, but a lot of corners, and that's where we really shine.
Car has been working well, and the other thing is they get good fuel mileage. One pit stop is all it's going to take. So Andrew Carbonell is going to have an hour and a half worth of work in front of him to get to the checkered flag and try to win this thing.
The other great thing about these Mazdas, you talk about cornering ability. The other thing with the stock gearbox is how the gear ratios are matched to a particular circuit. And I know a couple of years ago when these guys dominated here, the Mazdas, it was, you talk to the drivers, they said it's always, we see Liam in a little bit of trouble here trying to find a gear. But they talk about the gear ratios, how they're suited to the corner, Bob. It's not like a regular race car. We can change each ratio for a particular corner. They're really much set, so it just really, does it suit the circuit or not? Are you in between gears in a particular corner?
Keep in mind.
Calvin, Spencer Pompelli was saying the exact same thing about his Cayman. He said, we're just off a little bit on gears. The Mazda seemed to be a little bit better. But the other thing that we've been talking about a lot is heat and what that does to the tire. Remember, the Mazda is some 500 pounds, almost 500 pounds lighter than the Porsche Cayman. And that weight really helps save these Continental tires, especially in this Texas heat.
That's great. That wasn't looking good. But we're riding on board now with Scott Maxwell in the 15.
We talked about using the entire width of the track and beyond. Let's just take a lap with Scott Maxwell in this pole-sitting Ford Shelby GT350 RC. Watch and listen to him at work. Action in the pits. Here is the series leading number 6.
Yes, and this is a full-service pit stop right now, so Andrew Davis is out of the car. Robin Liddell is getting in. I talked to Robin right as he was getting his helmet on. I said, what's your mindset as you go into a situation like this? And he said, look, I don't have anything to fight with. We don't have anything left in the tank to battle out on the racetrack. So the only thing he is thinking about is not making any mistakes. He said, unfortunately, we have to hope that something happens to our competitors out there, because that's the only way we're going to be able to make up any more positions. That and execution in the pits. Pit stop was very quick, real complete.
Yeah, and the reason we're starting to see pit stops right now is certainly there's not a lot of fuel on board, but we've reached the 45-minute mark in this race that you need to score points to be eligible. The question is now you duck in immediately. It just means you've got to extend these next two stints a little bit further to about 51, 52 minutes. That was a 47-minute run for this team as Andrew now tries to recover from a hot stint.
Wow. He looks beat. We saw him earlier this year do an absolute Ironman stint. I think it was Sebring, Florida. Jim Campbell, who runs a motorsports program for Chevrolet, came up to him and gave him a big attaboy when he finally got out of the car.
Yeah, I mean, these are tough conditions, but these guys are used to it now. We've seen some extreme conditions already this year, Justin, and, you know, certainly you've got to do your fitness. You've got to be right, but there's nothing like being in this environment before, realizing what you need to improve on and being ready for the next one.
And we've been on such a tear of great racing every couple of weeks now. These guys are right up to speed on their own. They're as fit as they can be and as race fit as they can be, but and certainly Scott looks a lot better than I used to when I got out of the car, Jamie.
Well, Andrew decided he wanted to look stronger for his on-camera interview, stood up out of the seat. But Andrew, we saw you when you got out of the car. Talk me through these conditions today.
It's very, very hot. And, you know, being from the Atlanta area, I know about heat, and it's not unlike a normal summer day there. And I do my training in this type of weather. So it wasn't too bad, and I got the short stint this race. So out of the car after 45 minutes. So that's not too bad. It's going to be warm. The end of Robin's stint will be tough. It's a bit disheartening on the straightaways. We've got a really good Camaro Z28R. The Stevenson Motorsports guys have worked really hard. The Continental tires were holding off really well, and I was happy with the degradation through the stint. So we're just going to hope for some luck. It's really kind of, as I say, disheartening watching the Porsche, our competition for the championship, just drive away.
You need to grab some water. Thank you.
Yeah, talking to that group, there is a lot of frustration. I mean, when you have a start to a year like they did, Justin, build a big points lead, then you see some little subtle adjustment of performances, and they're really defenseless, we said in the open. I mean, they just don't have anything, and they know that there's two tracks here at COTA and at Road Atlanta where there's a lot of straightaway. There's nothing they can do right now.
Nothing they can do apart from do everything they can right. And as Jamie said most observantly, that's the only game they can play. But it's a bit of a boring game. When you're racers, you really want to go out there and attack, and they can't.
Well, we're seeing right now.
Go.
And they've lost 7 points potentially today, and you do that twice, that 10-point lead is gone, obviously.
Yeah, a lot of frustration, but maturity, experience, and they got the driver lineup to try and hold on to this right now. The 78 car, look at the back of it. The rear left has certainly taken a bit of a beating there, Cal.
Well, I'm a little surprised that the 13 hasn't responded to the Stevenson cars coming in, because if we saw a yellow right now, pit lane would be closed. They'd lose that massive lead and really sort of like be rotated to the back of the pack. So we've got to see if this 78 car has some power in it and can continue.
Everything off and on, including the master switch. Confirm that the ignition is on, the fuel pump is on main.
Race director does not want to go yellow. They will give the team the opportunity to try and get that car moving. I'd have to think that Giovardi will try and get this car into pit lane ASAP.
Yeah, the pressure's on this lap. He's only got three or four more corners to go before the pit lane. He goes past the injured car, so to speak. So we're hearing the starter is not turning over. In
watch for the pit lights, but this time.
Yeah, they dodged a bit of a bullet here, because if that 78 car doesn't go in, you can see.
Get over to that dash line, over to the dash line.
They're like, get into the commitment line, get to the commitment line before it goes yellow. You could hear on the radio, they said, get to the commitment line.
He was saying, watch for the dashboard light, watch for the dashboard light. If it goes yellow, stay out, is what he was going to have to do. Otherwise, he'd be incurring a penalty on the way in. So he did slip in there, Calvin.
But being under that dotted line, he was committed. So even if the yellow came out then, he was good to go.
Well, you can see concern on the part of the team down here when that car had the problem on the racetrack, because Calvin, you were exactly right. If it had gone yellow, they would have gotten stuck out on the racetrack. They wanted to come in, wanted to do a few more laps before they did commit to that pit stop. But anytime you see a car with a problem on the racetrack, you got to panic just a little bit. Matt Plum getting in, He'll have the double step, so he will be exhausted. Remember those power steering problems that they had before. If you had it today in this heat, it would be brutal.
Both the number 14 and the 41 are in as well, and it was the same look of concern on their faces because they would have been caught out had the caution come also. I talked to Kevin Dorn, and he said their pit window here is extremely small, only 6 minutes, so not even three laps of flexibility that they have. A caution would have hurt them. These are standard pit stops right now. Driver change, fuel, four new Continental tires on both cars. We're getting a lot of action. The 46 from Fall Line Motorsports also brought that BMW in, so Ashley Freiberg now getting out of the car. Trent Hinman will be getting behind the wheel of it. I talked to Trent out on the grid, and he has really good feelings about the race today because they have a car that is strong over the full stint. That's what they've been looking for. Full course caution light. The caution light's out on pit lane right now, but I think everyone made it, guys.
A little problem at the left rear for the 41 Nissan. And we have our first full course caution of the event. Roughly 53 minutes into this 2.5 hour event.
78 gets turned there by the Camaro of Anthony Mantella. It's actually Mark Wilkins now behind the wheel, but that may have happened after this incident, showing that Mark Wilkins took over here on the last lap. So I believe it was Anthony Mantella. A little bit of damage there, and there you see the spin in the following corner.
Yeah, kind of a curious place to spin, almost running in a straight line. So, were you committed or not when the yellow came out? Find out more. We'll sort it out for you when we return to the Circuit of the Americas for the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. Back at Circuit of the Americas, still under caution, but the pits are now open. All previous pit stops were legitimate, according to race control. Let's get down to Brian Till.
Multimatic, both cars are in right now. The 15 has come to the stop. A had problems with the balance of the car. And Scott Maxwell hands early on. Billy Johnson's getting in right behind them. You see Jake Buford taking over for Austin Cindric. They'll see if they can settle this 15 car down a little bit. And it heads back out with these conditions. Absolutely brutal in this heat, Jamie.
Well, problem for the number 34 from Alara out on the racetrack. The car was stopped. They said that the dash just lit up. Every light came on, and then it just shut off. So one of the most frustrating issues in motorsports, electrical issues, and that seems to be what they're having today.
The number 34 sat on pole in the street tuner division for today's race. And there it goes, back to the garage area.
Here we see Billy Johnson take the Multimatic Mustang out of pit lane. These guys just missed the opportunity to jump into pit lane like the remainder of the competition really did. They had to wait for the pit lane to open. They'll cycle to the back. They got a little bit more fuel on board, but a long road ahead of them.
We cut things terribly close here in the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. The Rum Bum Boys won their most recent victory at Virginia International Raceway when the two cars ahead of them ran out of fuel in the last two laps. We'll be back.
Continental Tire Sports Car Series action from a very, very hot Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas. And you got to be tough if you're going to play in this heat. And I don't have any friends that are much tougher than this guy, Liam Dwyer. Hey, buddy. Looks a little warm out there, to say the least, huh?
Yeah, it's a little bit warm. I think I was in better shape in Afghanistan. Those 100-plus degrees days didn't wear me out as much as this. But the car's in one piece. Those Continental tires were holding up. This Freedom Autosports Mazda MX-5 is still on point. It was able to run consistent laps in this 95-plus degree heat. Andrew Carbonell's got a good car. I didn't abuse the brakes too much. So we caught a caution at the right time. We'll see what Andrew could do late in the race here.
We're going back to green flag, but let me ask you a quick question. The pressure on your shoulders with Andrew Carbonell's championship there, do you feel it?
Oh, absolutely. But it doesn't mean we changed the strategy at all. The same strategy we've had all season. Run an easy race in the beginning. Hopefully keep the car in the top 10, top 15. Get Andrew a good race car for late in the race, and that's why we've done so well. I can't thank this Freedom Autosports team good enough or highly enough for the effort they put in. We've had long, hot days here at Austin, Texas at Circuit of the Americas, but I can't thank this team enough for how hard they've worked to give us a good car. Sounds like we just caught a caution. See what Andrew could do.
We'll see what they can do. I wish I could just be half as tough as this guy here. We'll see you guys.
Highly decorated military veteran. Is Liam Dwyer. And now it's in the hands of the ST points leader.
Oh, that was tight there with Billy Johnson and Mark Wilkins there. wild stuff as they head through turn 10 and swing down towards the brake zone for turn 11.
We've definitely seen different cars better at getting up to speed, Calvin. I think we're just seeing that coming
Jane
into play.
Buford alongside, yes. Two Multimatic Mustangs going side by side there, Justin. That was tight.
Yeah, it was tight. But you know, this track allows you to take all these different lines, and certainly everyone's exercising that new privilege right now. You know, also, we've had a lot of driver changes in that last. Remember, this is their first lap out in the race for nearly everybody.
Up front, Matt Blum, second of the championship, is first on the racetrack. Robin Liddell leads the championship. He is second. Here's some of that action again in the S's.
Wait, see there, Wilkins is trying to set up on Trent Hidman, and Billy Johnson takes the long way around, puts it to the inside. And as they hit the brake pedal pretty hard there to avoid contact, so nice clean driving there.
That was Trent Hidman in the 46. Fall line BMW up ahead, reigning GS champion. There you see him in the red, white, and blue BMW right of your screen, with the Camaro and the Shelby bearing down on him.
Yeah, it really is a battle of the American greats right now, as the number 15 is forcing his way through there. Billy Johnson obviously getting up right on the wheel there to in this last section. Oh, good Lord, nice comeback there.
Yeah, Wilkins isn't giving it up easy by any stretch. Good to see Mantella Autosport back this weekend for two cars. Missed a couple of rounds of the championship with this number 8 Gulf livery car.
These guys battle among themselves. Trent Hidman actually pulling away up ahead there as he chases the 41 Nissan.
And I think that's the thing that Robin Liddell needs to look out for. He's got a wingman right now in Lawson Aschenbach. You'd have to assume, with the championship as tight as it is, that he's going to try and help his teammate, but those Nissans have shown a lot of speed here today.
I talked to Mark Wilkins, Calvin, right before the green flag about missing those races and the effect it had. He said it feels like it hurt him pretty bad, just in terms of getting up to speed with the cars and gaining that experience. But he said they're not going out for a race win today. They just don't have the pace to do so. But he said they are out here having fun. He said it's great to be back.
I would imagine. In our most recent race of VIR, I said those Doran Nissan 370Zs were probably the fastest cars in the series who had yet to win races. There's one of them. That's the number 41 car, manned all season long by graduates of Nissan's innovative Nismo GT Academy, taking drivers from the virtual world of video games and turning them into real live racers on the track. Got a couple of quick Nicks in the car this weekend, and Nick McMillan and Nick Hammond.
Yeah, both guys doing a tremendous job, and it's still amazing. We talk about it every weekend, Justin, but the way that these gamers are transitioning to real car racing, particularly with a platform that is not stiff like a Formula car. You can see, you know, coming from the gaming screen and just translating over to a car that has a lot of downforce, very stiff platform, but there's a whole different dynamic with one of these cars.
And no one's ever accused a GT-style car of being like driving in a video game.
Right.
You know, it is in one of the big prototypes that we're seeing here at COVID this weekend, because they're so high downforce and so literally rigid and through the corners. But if you're watching this number 14 Nissan go through here, BJ Zacharias is having to really manhandle this car, and especially in the temperatures. I mean, unless your AC's broken, you live in Atlanta, you don't have to play video games in this kind of condition. So there's a whole load of dynamics that go into becoming a sports car driver. And a season in Continental Tires is certainly the way to get the fast education.
Certainly looking at how they run on the racetrack right now, obviously the rump bump machine had had the lead from the early stages, and rotating through the pit stops, they obviously had a bit of a break there with it not going early enough to really close the pit lane. But the Stevenson group just did a great job in getting their cars on and off pit lane and leapfrogging over the 14 machine.
Great battles going on as well. There are the leaders in ST, door to door. Eric Voss, Stephen McAleer.
Oh, look at that over under. Beautiful.
Using all the road on the exit there, which you can, as they're coming up to the final corner onto the straight. Remember, a good slingshot off this, nicely on the inside. Good, he did that well.
Steve, work, man, be careful. We're doing great here.
Coming up into turn one. But that doesn't count for anything, Calvin, as we've seen, because you can take any line you wish at the top.
Yeah, you got a lot of experience there behind the wheel of that 56 machine, and a champion in this series, Eric Voss.
And look who's looming behind, number 17, the RS1 Porsche Cayman.
When they don't have problems, Bob, they typically win.
Yep. Yep. Luis Rodriguez Jr. started the car in his rookie season. He and veteran teammate Spencer Pompelli have won 3 times. That's a series high.
When talking to the number 56 team, Bob, the experience of Eric Voss right now is really paying off, because they're having a gearbox issue. It's a downshift problem when they go into third gear. And he said Voss has dealt with it before, so it's going to be a little bit better when he's in the car, but it is something he's going to have to fight with.
Could be a real issue there. In the S's, climbing this hill and then diving downhill and uphill again to the very tight left-hander at turn 11 for the launch onto the long back straightaway at Circuit of the Americas. We'll be back with more after this. Welcome back to Circuit of the Americas and round 9 of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. Continental Tire is the official tire of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. There's the battle for second place, now held by that man, Spencer Pompelli, in the number 17 RS1 Porsche Cayman. He took it away from this man, 2014 ST Class champion, Eric Voss. Here's the pass.
Well, the long run uphill into turn one, and Spencer Pompelli looked like a man on a move. They've been so strong this year, going for their third win, and these guys finished first and second at the last round of the championship at VIR, and I don't think Spencer's charge may stop here.
Yeah, my call is that he is going to make his way to the front. That Cayman is so solid here, going through the corners. It's just, and Spencer's just so strong right now.
And remember that Jamie reported problems with the gearbox on that car, so Eric Voss has his hands full. He's an interesting guy and the subject of this edition of the Continental Tire For What You Do feature. Eric is a driver with an interesting take on the food he eats and the company he keeps.
I am a vegetarian. I started eating that way at the start of 2008 and just immediately felt like I had a better focus. Lost weight, which is always a big objective, right? But setting up for a race weekend and how I'm going to eat is probably the most difficult thing. So I'm always looking for a Whole Foods or some sort of a co-op close to the track, and I'll go there. And I'll sometimes, even if it's really close, go several times a weekend to get food, juice, all those things. My family's simple. It's my wife and my dog. And we don't have any kids, but the dog is too much work for me anyway. I'm too irresponsible to have kids. I have a little Cairn Terrier. He was a rescue. And as some people may know, Cairn is what Toto was in The Wizard of Oz. And ironically, we rescued him from Kansas. So we thought it was fitting. We drove up to Kansas, picked him up. And he's just one of those little scrappy terriers. And I think he's got more heart than anyone. But he's always pushing my buttons.
Well, Eric, don't let being irresponsible prevent you from having kids. Look at us.
Yeah, no, I know. It's a whole lineup of fabulous offspring in this booth, and fabulous offspring ourselves. No, and don't be misled when we see these profiles. It portrays these drivers as gentle, family-loving animal vegetarians, but on tracks they're meat-eating monsters, and that's what we're here to watch. And Eric will be a little annoyed right now, not thinking vegetarian, vegan thoughts about the fact that Spencer's just driven away from him.
Right. Spencer's probably the guy who led him down that path, because Spencer is very much on that routine as
right.
well. They both used to live in Atlanta, whereas Eric now lives in Dallas, Texas, so a local race now for him.
A long way from the days of James Hunt. Let's just say we've come.
Yes.
Exactly.
There's your leader in class, Stephen McAleer. And the number 5, CJ Wilson, racing Mazda MX-5.
Andrew Carbonell has worked his way up into the 6th position as we talk about the championship. So that caution was really beneficial to that 2016. They needed that to get back in the game here today.
Talking about the way, you know, right at the top of the show, these cars are going to deteriorate, and I actually somewhat incorrectly, it now turns out, said these guys can hold a pace throughout the whole of their stints. The lap times are definitely slower by a second and a half, 2 seconds in this stint than they were right at the beginning of the race. It is heating up out there. I'd love, maybe Brian, Jamie, if you could give us an update on what the temperature is down in the pit lane, because in our booth it's actually almost chilly enough for our iced tea.
Well, just so we don't have any iced tea issues, it is very hot outside, but I do have a track temperature update. It's now up to 112 degrees, so a 9-degree increase since this race started, and with just over an hour remaining, they're expecting that temperature just to keep going up. The danger zone for the drivers, though, is when it gets to about 120 degrees track temperature. They say that's when the tires really fall off, and that's when they need to be at the top of their game in order to manage it.
Seeing a great little battle here between Andrew Carbonell, who's now taking the fifth position away from Ryan Eversley. Eversley had a charge down the front straightaway. It looks like that Civic's got a little bit more horsepower and straightaway speed, but certainly that Mazda's working really well here. Great onboard shot looking out the back towards that Hart machine that now runs in the sixth spot.
Yeah, Ryan's really having to work. You can see his car's moving around a lot. He's using actually still every legal inch of the track, even though he has a little more space there to throw his car around. But as I said earlier, it's not always an advantage to running all the way wide as I watch him go 20 feet offline. But, you know, they're definitely by now found the natural rhythm of this track within these new regulations. They found where you can make the most of running wide rather than holding it tight.
Let's get down to Brian in the pit lane.
Chad McCummey down here at CJ Wilson Racing, standing next to CJ. But Chad, let's talk about the racetrack first, especially the competition right now. Looking in the mirror, I know we can see that Porsche coming. What do you guys have for the Cayman?
Well, we just got to keep executing and doing exactly what we've done. You know, our CJ guys have gave us a great mod space Mazda today, and I really feel like we've got the best car in the long run for sure. We just got to take care of it and save a little bit of fuel, save some tires, and I feel like we'll be there the rest of the race.
CJ, I know you're a huge race fan, but also when you think back to your career, your athletic career, you know what these guys are going through, chasing a championship. Is there anything that you have in your history that you can pass along to them to help keep them focused?
Well, in this kind of heat, you know, the biggest thing is not to try to push yourself too hard. There's obviously really stiff competition in our class. You see all the cars are running very similar lap times, and today with the a little bit of extra room on the exit curb, it looks like everyone's going a lot faster than normal.
Well, I know you're a huge race fan as well. Kind of bittersweet that you're here because that scar on your left elbow is the reason. We're going to see you at Petit. I know the baseball season won't be over with by then.
Yeah, I'll be at Petit. You know, hopefully we're still racing for the championship at that point. If we keep going well, then, you know, it looks good for us as a team. It's frustrating, like you said, to miss the rest of the season, but I, you know, try to make the most of it, and I'm kind of lucky that I get to come out here today.
And they're looking forward to the checkered flag at this racetrack. It's where the team won their first ever race, so they're looking to collect another one here and maybe move forward in the championship, guys.
Well, I think Brian was onto something there, asking CJ Wilson if his baseball career had taught him anything about pitching in the heat. He had a long career with the Texas Rangers in Arlington, Texas, which I believe holds the record as the hottest stadium in Major League Baseball. In fact, there's all the talk about playing too many day games in that stadium because it gets so hot.
Just relating to something that Chad McCombie mentioned, he said, hopefully we got enough gas. Now, I hate to bring this up, but whenever we get into a fuel crisis management, Spencer Pompelli seems to end up on the bad side of those deals.
You think his team are thinking that right now? I definitely do. Tough road mapping it out to the end of the race, Bob.
The team will be telling him that Calvin brought it up. They would have four victories on the year, but for the fact that they ran out within sight of the checkered flag at Road America in Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. We'll be back with more from Texas. Whoa, the accordion effect at the pit entrance. Everybody trying to get to service as we are under our second full course caution of the event here in round nine of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. To Brian Till.
Well, this full course caution played at just the right time for these guys. It's still going to be very close to make it to the end on fuel for new Continental Tires. A full load of fuel going in for Matt Plum, and then he'll head back out. And it is brutal conditions on the racetrack right now, Jamie.
Also, as I'm pretty certain, the entire GS field hit pit lane, so both the six, the championship leading six, and the number nine sister car also on pit lane right now. The tires are going to fill them up with fuel. Then on pit lane, the 41 holding, and the 14 are also holding, on pit road for full service.
Look at that, four tire change for Rumbum, only two for Stevenson. Great strategy there by Mike Johnson on the box, saying that's the only way we can get track position here today.
Be really hot inside those cars after that yellow sitting around behind the pace car.
Well, late word from the pit lane was that the six did not get a full load of fuel, and they're instructing Liddell to conserve.
It will be close though, Bob. I mean, I think what they're doing is they were just watching where the 13 car was, and I mean, with the championship time as tight as it is, they had to push. It's going to be tight anyone for everyone, as you can see the number on the board, and the cars were only going about 50 to 52 minutes, so it's full fuel save now for Rob Liddell. He's got a wingman again though.
A Another break coming up. We'll have the green on the other side. Stand by. A great hour of Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge action coming your way when we return. Well, here's a look at some of the drivers after climbing out of their race cars in the first hour of round nine of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. Some are smiling, some were angry, but all were overheated. No reports of anything serious down there in the pit lane. Boy, oh boy. It is a long day's work. Temperature now unofficially 93 degrees. Add another couple of degrees when the sun breaks through the clouds like that over Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas, where we are about to go green after our second full course caution of the day.
Do you feel that heat, Bob, as we see Jake Buford, it looks like, dive to pit lane? Yes, he does. So again, Multimatic, different strategy there. No, he doesn't. He stays out as a different Mustangs. We get the green.
The V8 thunder going up pit lane here. Fantastic. Up into turn, went uphill. It really is amazing for spectators. This is the best spectating spot on the track. As you can see, many lines through there. As Robin Liddell is trying to be a little bit more economical with his line to get a faster shot through these S's. Using all the inside there up on the apex curve. That's where you've got to be careful.
Look at Liddell. He's got two tires. He's looking to the inside of Jake Buford, but the team will be telling him that Buford will need fuel. He doesn't want to get too aggressive here.
Want to or need to, in fact, but he does want to keep the pressure on because this is their chance for Stephenson to look strong at this point of the race. They haven't seen the front end of this for a long time.
Well, three more cars back is the car that Robin Liddell is really concerned about, and that is the bright yellow and blue Porsche 911 of Matt Plum.
Concerned for Liddell again. Just to reiterate, we heard the call that he's a little bit tight on fuel there to what we call short fill him. To leapfrog around the run bump machine. They were basically looking at pit lane. That's one advantage you have when the run bump car's pitting at pit in. You can see him coming and just release your car to ensure that you beat him out onto the racetrack, and that's the ploy that they used. Jake Buford last pitted on lap 23, which is some 12 laps earlier than the rest of these cars right behind him, so I don't think there's any way that he's going to make it on fuel here today unless we see a majorly long yellow. See Matt Plum being very patient there as Billy Johnson looks to the inside of Lawson Aschenbach.
Yeah, I was about to say, I think Matt is being patient because right now we have the battle of the Americans right in this top four.
Marcelli there looks to the inside.
Yeah, and I don't blame him either. He's got to get a bit sporty. He's really a fantastic young driver that's trying to get his name noticed, and there's no point in doing that dawdling around. So there's a lot going on here.
GS battle on the left, ST battle on the right. Stephen McAleer, the number five CJ Wilson Racing Mazda, leads Spencer Pompelli and Eric Foss.
Yeah, McAleer and Pompelli, fastest lap. They're kind of in a league of their own, about half a second spread over the rest of the field. So you'd expect it to come down to one of these two cars for the victory. But Foss, they're hanging on as he runs really wide through that corner.
We've noticed certainly that the Cayman doesn't have to run as much of the track as the Mazda. But we're joining back up at the front, obviously, in GS. Jay Buford has managed to hold on. He's actually looking quite strong coming onto the pit straight there. Matt getting, looking, seeking to sort of see the eye line going up into turn one there. But again, as you see the inside, oh, Billy Johnson having a look and
watch for Plum if he can time this and cut back underneath. He looks to the inside of Lawson Aschenbach as they really squirm the power down there, asking everything from those Continental tires.
Boy, they've got to be so careful. You don't want to risk it all.
Plum looks to the inside. The variety of lines you can run through this very wide racetrack is unbelievable here through the S's.
But not side by side as you approach the apexes. If you're on the outside, you are going to come off worse. But Matt just has to be, you know, he's not being, you know, he's keeping the pressure on because he needs to, but he certainly doesn't want to let them run away, and he certainly doesn't want to get himself into trouble. Jamie?
Well, Mike Johnson, you're the guy that's got to make those tough strategic decisions for Stephenson Motorsports. Two tires only for each car, short filling. What effect are you hoping that's going to have?
Well, there's been no passing at all today, really. This is kind of a follow the leader track, and we have no straight line advantage right now. So the only thing we can do is get track position. The way that yellow came out, we knew that it was going to get us really close to the window. So we just said, I saw those guys take four. As soon as I saw them coming down the line, we had to go. Obviously, if they would have been in front of us, it might have been different, but where they were in the pits, so I'm come about halfway, and we sent both cars, and we said, you know, We're keeping both cars up front for as long as we can. The good news is that both of our drivers are doing a great job. Our Camaros are hanging in there best they can, and all we got to do is stay close to that 13 car. You know, and that's our main goal, is trying to keep everybody else not between us or not allowing anybody to get there. And Lawson is fighting with everything he has back there to fight for position. And, you know, we got 45 minutes to go and just going to hang on best we can.
You took right side tires on the number 6, rear tires on the number 9. Why the difference?
Really driver choice. You know, and actually it was a difficult call to go left, right, or rear. The rears go off quicker. The rights lead on to the straights, but the lefts are the big sweepers. So you might gain more lap time in the left, but it doesn't help you where the rights maybe get you onto the straights. So we let each driver let their decision and off we went.
All right, we'll see what effect it has. Thank you. Brian?
Yeah, from the Stevenson Camaros to the Rumbum Porsche, Joe Vardy, you guys took 4 tires, so the car should be well balanced. But with the time remaining, what's that going to be? How close is it going to be on fuel?
It's going to be really close. Hopefully our 4 tires stop. When it's pretty hot out there, the other car should be dropping off, so it's going to be close.
Close enough that you're going to have your driver conserve, or can he go for it?
I can go for it.
There you heard it, guys. 4 new tires, and they're going to go for it.
Well, as Mike Johnson was talking from the Stevenson camp, you saw him glancing at the screen. He was watching as the 13 car went by Lawson Aschenbach in the number 9 and moved up into 4th place.
We just saw a little bit of contact. Robin Liddell touching, nudging, kissing the back of Jay Buford's car as he went through turn 1. Everyone is running close through here. Remember, these guys have raced together all year, so there's no surprises in what the guy's going to do in front or behind you. It's just where and when they're going to do. Look at the
difference.
Here we go.
This for the lead in ST. Pompelli and McAleer going for it on the exit of turn 1. Long right-hand sweeper downhill through turn 2, and then the S's begin.
You almost needed radar to find him then. It was incredible how wide he could go. So nice. That Mazda looks so good through these S's here. Spencer, of course, is
easy on those curves there, man. Easy on the curves. They got to make it to the end here.
And the reason he's telling him to be easy, even though the apex curb is low, behind it at 11 of the 20 corners on this track, there's a larger bright orange. You saw one right there, sort of extra speed bump. And you hit that, and you could have problems.
Pompelli looks good though, doesn't he? He's menacing, just sitting there. That Cayman looks really strong. He looks to the inside, not going to make a move there down into turn 11. He's going to be a tough man to hold off here today.
It's not if, it's when. And he's just stalking his prey right now.
On board with Robin Liddell on the left side of your screen.
Tell you what, I heard that message from Joe Vardy saying, no, he can just go for it. I don't necessarily believe it. I think for Matt Plum, if he can save a little bit of fuel, if this goes green the rest of the way, it's going to be tight for these drivers in GS to make it as Pompelli makes the move.
Well, you know, we heard Mike Johnson talk about it a second ago. It is hard to pass here. There hasn't been a lot of passing, just the speed these cars are running. So right now, a bit of track position, which Spencer's just got, pull out a little bit further, he can then start to conserve. If he can pull a couple of seconds over the next 4, 5, 8 laps, he'll be able to start to conserve.
Great battle. Top 3 have broken away slightly in ST. There's the 6 attacking 158 of Jade Buford.
Well, Jade has got a lot more miles on those tires. Remember, Robin only took 2, but it should give him an edge here. Oh, Buford there a little bit. That was strange.
That was a gear. Don't you?
And then the team told Chain, we are told, to let the sister car come by. See Billy Johnson there, but let only Billy Johnson by, no one else.
Well, guess what? Plummer's got by, and now Aschenbach looking for a way through as well. Pretty defenseless at this point.
Wow. Still nose to tail. We'll take another break and return. 40 minutes and change remaining here at Circuit of the Americas. Stay with us. Back at Circuit of the Americas, and a massive twist in the championship story in GS. There is the Rumbum Porsche in the hands of Matt Plum, who came on to the start-finish straightaway, slowed dramatically just as we received words that he had lost a belt in the engine bay of the Porsche, and then with fluid streaming everywhere, he pulled off on the run-up to turn 1. Now he'll coast backwards into the runoff area and out of this race.
Watch this. You can see Billy Johnson get all the way to the other side of the racetrack. He saw fluid coming out of the run bump machine earlier than we did, and there you can see it. What a devastating blow. Looked like Rumbum were managing this race very well. He had pace, he'd moved up to second. The next man on his agenda was Rob Rizal in the lead, but this is a game changer.
Power steering just failed.
Do your best, Mustang with you, Mustang with you.
Had water pressure alarm, water tip. Lost the fan belt, you lost the fan belt. That's it.
He had power steering issues at the last round of the championship.
That's
managed
right.
to hang on, but I think this belt has got into another one. Spit it off. Game over.
Oh, to Brian. We saw Brian was talking with Joe Vardy, who gave him a look of resignation. I think maybe Brian had his headset off and didn't hear it.
Just very, you know, the tragedy here is that they were executing as they had to. Said at the top of the show.
Can get you back to the someplace where we can work on it.
Well, here's what it means. Championship isn't over, but look at that gap from Davison Liddell to the Plum Brothers, 25 points with 35 points for a victory as they go to the season finale at Road Atlanta. Now to Brian.
Joe Vardy, we just spoke to him a few minutes ago about fuel, and we didn't want to have to talk to you again this quickly, Joe. One belt in the back of that Porsche, and that pretty much controls everything, correct?
Yeah, it does. I think we got bumped in the back, and I think that messed the belt up, but I don't know. We worked pretty hard on this thing. I just want to thank everybody that helps us, Mr. Bacardi, all the Bacardi people and families, and I'm sorry for them. They put so much into this, and I feel pretty bad letting them down.
Well, I don't think Joe Vardy let them down. It's that belt in the back, and we've seen it with Porsches before, but it doesn't really matter. When that belt's gone, so is your race.
That is just simply incredible. As Brian said, they have had issues last year. They had some problems they had to get around, and they just positioned themselves perfectly. Both teams executed to the maximum here today in terms of their on-track performance, in terms of speed, their strategies. Chasing it around a little bit, different strategies to try and get track position, but you hate to see it end this way, Justin. You wanted to be on the racetrack.
Yeah, everybody did, everyone to the competition, but as we catch up here, Bob.
A few laps ago, the 14 wound up off track, and this is how it happened.
He says he got tipped, and the next man in the picture there was Lawson Oschenbeck, the number 9 on the radio. I think BJ thought it might have been the BMW. Let's take another look here.
Oh, Oschenbeck off and on himself.
Yeah, he was abusing those track limits, certainly able to on the track out, but he wasn't able to gather it back up as BJ got on the brakes.
He didn't want to go behind the apex of the next corner, which is a no-no.
Yeah, he really got whacked there when he didn't. He was an innocent bystander there. That was a bit unfortunate, but in Lawson's defense, he was actually solving his own issues at the time, wasn't he? So what a change up for Stevenson.
Oh, boy. You can almost hear the sigh of relief from Robin Liddell in the 6.
Yeah, we said at the top of the show, they've come so close. Runner-up the last 3 seasons in a row. And they could see this championship lead dwindling, and they could see the pressure that this Rumbum team were putting on them. But I don't think even they would like to win it this way, and it's going to be so tough now. Almost a disaster would be needed at Petit for this being turned around.
Well, the Rumbum crew have won a couple of championships. Right now, it's all disappointment. Nick Longhi gives Joe Vardy a hug. It's going to be all right. We've still got a race to go. Back at Circuit of the Americas, the battle continues in the street tuner class between leader Spencer Pompelli and runner-up Stephen McAleer. Enter the final 27 minutes of this race.
Yeah, and I thought once Spencer got the lead, Justin, he may sort of like sneak away from McAleer right now, but McAleer is just staying in the game there. His little terrier, the Scottish Terrier, we can call him today, because he's not letting him go. And he's starting to explore these track limits a little bit more. You see him using more and more asphalt on the exit of these corners to stay in touch with Spencer.
Yeah, he's definitely using experience to and exploring the track. Look at him there. That was a great example. He's using everything he actually has and is available to him under these new rules at this track to allow him moving. But watch this. This was an incident that happened earlier.
Down into turn 15. It's a tight corner, and it's very inviting to dive down the inside. But that's not like Trent Hindman. he's our defending champion, and he's just a little bit too aggressive there, maybe a little too impatient, and tips that car around Marcelli and gets the penalty.
That penalty was a drive-through, so Trent Hindman, reigning GS champion, is now 10th.
Watch this as we come through these final couple of corners. Watch McAleer come off this corner. He uses a lot of road here, trying to get a run down into 20.
And now we understand the number 9, Lawson Aschenbach, has been called to the pit lane for this incident, as he plows right into the back of the 14 Nissan.
Yeah, we'd seen that one before, Bob, of course, and Lawson just got really wide out on those rumble strips. He couldn't get on the brakes there, and suddenly BJ was braking. He just didn't have enough room to get it rolled up. I don't think that was aggressive, just a little bit of a mistake on the previous corner.
You could just tell the way he hit the brakes and the weight transfer in the car, so suddenly he had no intention of doing that.
Right.
Very frustrating. I tell you what, Spencer is blown away and irritated right now. Stephen McAleer is driving so well behind him. Spencer, I forecast that he'd pull out. He probably told that he would, and it hasn't happened. The pace of that Mazda behind is really irritatingly good. Although, if Spencer has to save fuel, Calvin, he only has to stay in front. He knows he can't go by, but this is a little close for comfort.
It really was. It was tight on fuel. They got that other caution. Brian, what are you hearing down on pit lane?
I just checked with the team on fuel and on the basics of the car in general, how it's working right now. They said that last full course caution has made him good to go on fuel. But as we talked about at the very beginning of the show, tire degradation could be the issue in this heat here at COTA. It's one of the things that Spencer pointed out early on. Remember, somewhere between 400 and 500 pounds heavier is that Cayman than the little Mazda right behind it. It really kind of depends on who you talk to. The Mazda says, it's not that much heavier. But of course, the Porsche guys want to lament just how much heavier it is. But that extra weight wears on those Continental tires in the heat of the day, and they're really worried about keeping those tires underneath Spencer to the checkered flag.
Yeah, we're not talking about 5 minutes to go. There's 23 minutes still on the clock, JB, so anything can happen here. This is going to be a tight battle to the end.
And as fans of the series know, we often see the car in second place, the car running behind in pursuit, if you like, is the one that actually can control the situation. He's able to pick his braking points off the car in front. He's able to use the line, especially here, as we're seeing very flamboyant lines. But look at him go out there.
Yeah.
That is 30 feet out from the normal allowed racing limits. And then he has a different line through this right. I think he's visually just trying to unsight Spencer and actually just annoy the heck out of him.
Well, I think he's experimenting too. I mean, suddenly these track limits change during the course of these weekends, and suddenly the driver has to approach the racetrack very differently. He's got a gauge in front of him. It's like, okay, if I try this wider line, does this get me closer to Spencer? And maybe he can then piece the whole lap together to put these limits together the most effectively he can.
As you pointed out earlier, Justin, wider radius, carry more speed through the corner, but that probably means more revs in the engine, and that affects your fuel mileage. Let's get back to the GS story with Jamie.
But you guys just used that word experience again. And Kevin Doran, we talk a lot about this GT Academy and the drivers that you have shuffling through. They don't carry a lot of race experience. It's all from gaming. As a team owner, how do you adjust to that?
Well, I guess my 36 years should rub off on them a little bit and help out a little bit. But that's their only shortcoming. Speed-wise, they're very, very good. Technically, they're very, very good. Everybody we've had so far, I think we're on our fourth GT Academy guy. And the Nissan training program is superb, and they're just ready to race. But they don't have that race craft. So, and only experience will give them that. So we try and help them, try and guide their decision making as best we can. But it's that race craft decision making that they need to learn.
Right now your two cars, the 14 and the 40 run, are running third and fourth respectively. What little bit more do you guys need to get to the top step of the podium?
We've been flirting with winning for 2 years, I guess. But it's close. It's right around the corner. You know, who knows? Maybe today. You know, it's our car's good at the end of the long run, and the VA cars taper off a little bit. So maybe yet today, and Atlanta should be good for us also. So hopefully we'll get one or two before the end of the year.
The other thing those GT Academy guys don't have is track experience too at each specific track. Many times they come into these places for the very first time. The performance they put in, you know, qualifying on the second row here yesterday, is absolutely sensational. This is not a weak field, even with the qualifying and the starting drivers. Some stellar guys in this championship.
Said, speed is not a problem, it's just racecraft. I mean, I've seen Kevin Durant on the pit box, as you have. From the 80s, from the heydays with my dad and Al Holbert. I mean, he was there, right? So that is a lot of data in that mind that, unfortunately, you can't give someone experience. You can tell them all the stories, and they have to find out for themselves. And these guys certainly have got the cars underneath them.
And Kevin is a true racer. He has fielded cars in a number of different disciplines, including dirt track and more.
Look at this, Marcelli is driving the wheels off that Camaro there. He chases down Jake Buford for the fifth spot. Espinlab having a nice run here in the Aston Martin as well. He's very much in the mix right now.
Yeah, I don't know. The tires may come off before the wheels, I think, for
Marcelli to the inside here in turn 11.
Let's see if he can make it stick.
Watch Jade, though. He'll tuck it back to the inside, try and straighten the wheel a little bit sooner and get the power down. Espinlab takes advantage. There's Wilkins in the picture, too.
Yeah, look, the Aston's going all the way down the inside. Oh, that was his one move, I think, he used.
And Charles Espinlab will not be intimidated. He's one of the tougher guys in this championship, so Marcelli thought about closing the door completely, and Charles said, well, guess what? Three wide through either way.
Whoa.
Good stuff.
Nicely done there, wasn't it?
Well, the nice thing is, with a track like this, it does give you that extra margin. If suddenly someone doesn't give you the room, there's a little bit more out there if you need it. And Wilkins is caught up with all of the argy-bargy going on here.
I tell you what,
Espinlab picked up a couple of positions there in one corner.
Yeah, Kyle is driven literally.
Watch Wilkins here. He can take advantage here, possibly.
Yeah, Kyle's tires are done right now. He's pushed that to the limit and passed it. So he's definitely in the number 80 there. That was looking too loose to be able to stick it.
And Charles Espinlab's known as one of these old school kind of drivers that can just get in and drive anything. He doesn't need any of the fancy driver comforts or any of the little extra controls on the steering wheel, except for today he is actually wearing a cool suit for the first time. He said, not helping him right now though, guys.
Just lost the rear end under braking there. I'm not sure if it was with the downshift at the same time, but suddenly the Aston lost the grip that he needed, just pushing things hard as he'd made up a couple of spots on that lap.
I wouldn't be surprised if Charles Espinlab has a bit of a smile behind that helmet. Just came in a little too hot, and around he went. We'll be back. Welcome back to Circuit of the Americas. The action continues now with just under 14 minutes remaining in round 9 of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge with Calvin Fish, Justin Bell, Brian Till, and Jamie Howe. I'm Bob Varsha. There is your race leader with a great big piece of racetrack to take him on his way. As Robin Liddell and teammate Andrew Davis now firmly in control of not only the race, but the championship with one round to go at Road Atlanta. Here's the second place car, Billy Johnson, nearly 6 seconds behind race leader Liddell.
Yeah, Billy Johnson has certainly given it 1,000,000% here today, JB, but he doesn't seem to have the pace right now of Rob Nadal. And this is a little bit of a surprise. Looking at the practice sessions this weekend, it looked like the Camaros were going to be in trouble. But again, we talked about executing to perfection. That's what Stevenson has done here today. Got the maximum out of the day. Obviously, a little bit of time still on the clock.
So join up with the front here in ST. Spencer Pompelli, you know, he is driving the two of them, Stephen McAleer and Spencer, are driving these cars to the limit. You've got a Cayman versus a Mazda, and they are absolutely on the limit. They have literally been like they've got a tow rope between them for the past 25 minutes, and it's certainly great racing, and it's certainly showing that two drivers at the top of their game in the ST class are really making the most of this track. And it's interesting, we've seen McAleer using all the track, as you said, to explore, to experiment, to make the most of trying to stay on the back of Spencer's car. But it's settled down a bit now, and Bet Spencer's really happy about that, because it was a bit frantic, wasn't it?
It really was, and I love when they go through the S's here. McAleer's a little bit further behind now to really demonstrate this, but when they were kind of half the gap they have right now, he was really attacking in some very surprising places. And I think from Spencer's standpoint, you just got to ignore that rear view mirror and just do your line, because if you're just worried about where he's going to go, it could really throw you off your game.
Guys, just checked in with Chad McCombie. I said, you know, you've been watching this battle with Stephen McAleer and Spencer Pompelli. Do you see a chink in the armor? Is there anything that you can tell him about where to make the move? And he said, it's just been kind of one move against the other, and he doesn't really see any weakness. He said, I think he's saving up for one move. It's going to come down to one move at the end, Jamie.
Well, I told you, when we get up to 120 degrees on the track temperature, that's when it gets really, really greasy out there and hard to control the cars. Take a look at this. I just checked it. 131.5 degrees is what we're at right now. We started this race at just over 100, so big increase here today.
Great stuff, Jamie. Well, if it's that hot on the racetrack, imagine how hot it is in the race car. Let's listen to some radio.
Buddy, are you staying cool enough and drinking water out there?
Oh, yeah. Woo!
Stephen McAleer, he's having fun.
No fun at all.
And I think there's a very good point about making that one move. He's been close to Spencer. He certainly analyzed his line. He may see a weakness, a chink in the armor that he's going to try and save for the last lap or two so that Spencer doesn't have time to respond. But he's a canny old dog, Spencer. It's not going to come easy, the win here today.
Yeah, he's not going to get hustled like that. But he's certainly, I tell you what, he can't respond in terms of performance right now. He might know where to put his car to lock McAleer, but I don't think he knows he's got anything left in the car. Otherwise, he'd be seeing it right now.
And the deal is, with this racetrack, you can surprise someone because there are such a variety of lines you can run that if he's thinking, I'm just going to dive bomb him here, suddenly it's like, whoa, where did he come from?
We just saw the perfect setup there coming through 19 into 20. He could go through 19 carrying 3 or 4 miles an hour faster and literally hole shot him up into 20 and just try and get on the inside and then cause whatever trouble he can, and then them both have a drag race up the straight. It's very possible to do that there. We've started to see these lines come into play.
The big factor, of course, is the championship. How much does he want to put on the line for the win with the championship on the line going up against the Freedom Autosport Master at the same time?
It's all about the big picture in these final races of the season. It's almost last call, gentlemen. Less than 10 minutes remaining. We'll take a break and return to take you to the checkered flag in round 9, the Continental Sports Car Challenge. Back at Circuit of the Americas in round 9 of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge, watching the battle for the lead in Street Tuner. GT leader Robin Liddell has pulled away from Billy Johnson by about 2.5 seconds. This is the closest battle of meaning on the racetrack. Spencer Morbelli over Stephen McAleer, and you could see the gap.
Yeah, it's really tightened up here. It looked like Spencer had it well in hand here and pulled out probably about 6 car lengths, and suddenly it's game on again. Stephen McAleer has found some pace. He had a little bit in hand, it seems like, and he slows right back on. We've been sort of like debating where he may make that move, Justin, if he has one in his hand that he's kind of seen where Spencer may have a weak point. What do you think?
Well, I think you're going to see him setting up for it in the section coming up now. Spencer's very tidy through this, but as the exit of the double left-hander here, he runs very wide. Look at him all the way out there, and then he doesn't go on quite such a wide line. He tucks it in, and of course that time he didn't, but normally he tucks it on the inside there, and we think he's going to try and feed his way to the inside there. So through turn 19 and 20, he's going to be making his move. Maybe he didn't that lap because he didn't want to give his hand away. Bob's looking like the wise old owl over there.
Oh yeah, I got two acclaimed racers next to me, and I'm going to call it strategy? I don't think so.
We're also hearing that Stephen has been on the radio asking the team, where are the GS leaders? So maybe his game plan is when the GS leaders come through, and they're not that far behind right now. It could happen in the last 5 minutes of this race. Maybe he's going to try and set him up when Spencer has to let the faster cars through.
It looks like he lost a little bit down the front straightaway that time. But the other thing, guys, when you think about it, by opening up the exit, what he's doing is taking load off of the tires. And we talked about trying to make sure that you could conserve and have that shot at the end. Maybe the other thing Stephen McAleer is doing, maybe he's picked his spot. He wants to have the best Continental tires that he can.
Tell you what, Robin Liddell did not get a good run through traffic on that previous lap. He had about a 5-second lead on Billy Johnson a few minutes ago. Now it's down to just under 2.5 seconds. So it's definitely tightened up. And Billy Johnson, I mean, yes, he will care about not affecting a championship, but he's certainly going to go for it here if there's the opportunity to grab a win.
In fact, his teammate Scott Maxwell, who put that car on pole, said, we've taken a pole. We need to do the double and take the win from pole. They've got that chance today. There's our Continental Tire recap of the Lone Star Le Mans. You know the leaders. Just two full course caution, but for a lengthy seven laps of this 3.4-mile circuit, six lead changes, four cars officially out of the nearly 40 that started the race. Looking for a white flag, perhaps this lap.
That will be for the overall leader, which is this guy, Rob Liddell, behind the wheel of the number six. The question mark will be, can he get to those ST leaders and effectively take a lap off the distance they'll have to run here today? But this is the sort of traffic you've got to deal with. And through the S's, you can lose a ton of time.
Look at Ryan Eversley putting up a bit of a fight there in that ST Honda.
ST cars are very nimble through the tighter parts of this racetrack, so they don't give up much to the more powerful GS machines. And Ryan's in a great battle here today as well. Just inside the top 10, so fade a little bit, but certainly that Hart machine was up in the big points earlier on. Johnson gets a clean run through there, through turn 11. He can see the leader right now. He can smell him. He's going to go after him.
Yeah, it went down to 1.3 as they passed the finish line that last lap before they entered the fast S's. So this is very possible for him with a lap and a third to go. So he is going to be taking close observation of how the traffic is allowing Liddell through.
We can, he could probably take advantage. You don't think that Rob Liddell is going to defend too vigorously if he can get right to him. He realizes the situation with the run bump machine out of this race, that he can't afford to just think about the win and consider being tapped here by Billy Johnson and losing big positions.
Liddell just that lap, it all went wrong for him. I don't know if he suddenly got a mirror full and saw Billy Johnson behind, but he's not coming off the corners well. It looked very convoluted in the way the car was moving. He got it sideways. Billy Johnson just got a nice clean run through there.
Remember that two-tire stop.
Yeah.
That's right, very important. They did stake two tires on Rob Liddell, the right side tires. So maybe through the right hand as he's gonna struggle a little bit more when he's loading that left side up.
Okay, Billy Johnson will be using every bit of the road there, trying to come through turn 20, carry the most speed he can. Very important to get along a good hole shot there because you've got that uphill stretch. That gives you great perspective there as the white flag is flown. One thing's for sure, Rob Liddell is going to be very, very closely watching his mirrors. Billy Johnson moving around there under braking.
There's the ST battle now.
Doesn't look like these guys are going to get passed by the GS leaders, so they're going to have to finish this lap plus one more, and that just gives McAleer extra opportunities to try and wrestle this win away from Spencer Pumpelly. It hasn't been any closer than this.
Well, as you said, he knows by now where the weak links are for Spencer Pumpelly ahead, and
Spencer's so poised, though. I mean, he just positions the car. He takes it deep into the brakes. He doesn't try and grab into the corner to close the gap. He just tries to maintain the pace at the same time whilst defending.
Yeah, he doesn't even move across. Have you noticed that? He knows he's good under brake.
Maybe that's what Stephen McAleer has up his sleeves. He's realizing that Spencer's really not defending. Maybe he can just pull a surprise here, make a sudden move.
Turn 19, one more corner. They're on the start-finish straightaway with one lap ahead of them.
He's going to take a run here. He's got a big run. Can he get to the inside?
Sorry, that wasn't 19. That was 15. Here's 16, 17, and 18.
This is the important setup right now. He's got to come through turn 19 very well.
On board the second-place runner in GS, left side of your screen, leader up ahead.
It really ties that down in that. Oh, Johnson gets in a little bit too deep.
Wide.
He has to release the brakes there.
Oh, he's going to the inside.
McAleer
absolutely
down the inside.
20.
Oh,
beautiful. This is a drag race up the front straight here at Kota. That is good stuff.
Remember, these guys have another lap, Bob.
Exactly. Was that everything?
Ooh, white flag, buddy, white flag.
Was that everything McAleer had?
Yeah, was that the shot that he's thinking about?
That
Spencer will certainly be up to the task next time.
That was the move that we said he was going to pull, and he's going to try it the next lap too. Nothing that Spencer can do from in front to stop McAleer going so wide on the exit of 19 that he gets the shot coming into 20. Great stuff.
Race leader will be coming to the checkered flag momentarily.
Either way for McAleer is going to be a big win day. They should take the lead in the championship here tonight.
But you know, a win at Kota overall is pretty nice. You can pull it off.
Yeah, but the big prize is the championship. Don't, you know, you should come out of here as we see.
Keep going to the line.
Robin Liddell.
Points. Great job.
He makes sure of it, taking the checkered flag for the fourth victory of the season.
Thank you.
Teammate
Andrew
Davis.
That's one of the reasons fastest wins ever. Thank you so much. That felt so sweet.
And so they have their fourth victory. And
Magalette
now Spencer
to the
Papelli.
Inside. He yeah. takes the lead. Can he hold on to it?
Spencer Papelli will try to double back underneath.
Yeah, this is a drag race down. Oh. They're going to be absolutely door handle to door handle. There's looks bumps like as they come down this straight here.
Spencer has a little more top speed, it looks like. Now McAleer loads the gun another time.
Traffic in the way. Hopefully they won't be a factor here in this race.
Wow. This is not over, guys, because hey, he's going to pull that exact same move going in through 1920. I guarantee it. Watch him run wide here, trying to make as much use of momentum as he can. Traffic behaving very well. Great job there.
Going to keep pushing, he's going to keep pushing. He tried to get over to the left side of the straightaway, but he couldn't get there before Spencer retaliated.
Oh,
there's a look on the inside, wild.
He was lucky not to tap the back of his car there. That would have been an unfortunate way to end this race.
Yeah, that was awesome. Great car control there by McAleer. He's putting it all on the line here for the win. Here's the triple apex corner, 16, 17, and 18, and then turn 19.
Okay, how's this going to run down? You're going to watch McAleer go very wide on the exit of 19. He's going to carry that bit more speed through. Look at him go wide, and now he's going to hole shot. Where's he going to go? And down the inside. Oh, under brakes. Locking up sideways. Opposite lock as he carries it through to power up the straight there.
Drag race to the finish, but it looks like Spencer Papelli will hold on.
Guys, great job.
To take his fourth victory of the year with Luis Rodriguez Jr.
Cool as a combo.
Spencer Papelli, extraordinary, behind the wheel. That was a wonderful race there. I'm exhausted. I don't know about them.
That was fantastic.
I bet those two guys will share a hug after that battle.
Oh, fantastic.
Spencer, thank you very much. This was really important to me because of Justin's passing. I really appreciate it, buddy.
Celebration has begun. Share it with us from Circuit of the Americas in a moment. Back at Circuit of the Americas, Robin Liddell with co-driver Andrew Davis celebrating victory. And you can tell by that reaction from Liddell, he knows that this may well have been all the marbles in the championship. Even though one race remains at Road Atlanta. It's coming your way Sunday, October 18th, 9 to 11 a.m. Eastern Time on FS1. Results in Grand Sport.
Didn't see this one coming. I thought it was going to be a rum bum day, but they had disaster for the championship and today, JB.
Yeah, just tragic. But in ST there, I mean, it's got very tied up at the front end there.
Great battle in ST. But let's hear from our GS winner with Jamie.
Very different emotion from when I talked to you before you got in the car, Robin. It's been four races since you guys were on the top step of the podium. You said this one is so sweet. What makes this one special?
Just we had to work so hard for this. The last few races, to be quite honest, it looked like we didn't really have the pace to do it. Maybe Lime Rock, we had a chance, but even at VIR, although the lap times were decent, we couldn't race with the car in the current configuration. And obviously there's been a lot of talk about that, good and bad, but you know, to be quite honest, unless you're behind the seat of the race car, you don't really know what that's doing to your ability to compete on the racetrack. And you know, anyway, long story short, we're just absolutely delighted, as you can imagine. We never expected this today. I mean, I think it's a shame for Rum Bum that they had a bad day and their engine blew. I don't really like to win with a benefit of a competitor like that, but we did absolutely everything we could do to put us in this position, and it worked out perfectly. So I'm so proud of the team and so happy.
It's definitely a team effort. Andrew, congratulations as well.
And ST, Spencer Papelli, Luis Rodriguez, they take another victory. That's four on the season. But Spencer, in that last few laps, so impressive. Not a block, not a weave, not an early turn in. The guys were talking about it. You were confident in the car, confident in your line. How difficult was it to be that confident?
I was confident in Ren Sport 1. The guys gave me a fantastic car. I was confident in the Continental Tires. You know, that was a great race. Sometimes it's easy and sometimes it's not. Certainly wasn't easy today, but I'm so proud of our guys for putting this car together. We had a rough patch in the beginning of the year. That's through. Got a couple victories heading to Atlanta. I'm just, can't say thanks enough.
Congratulations on the victory. That's their fourth of the year, guys.
That's right, fourth win of the year for both our GS and ST winners. Let's have a look at the championship with one race remaining.
Well, a 28-point lead, 35 possibly on the tail, but if they start the race, that'll be enough for Davis and Liddell at Road Atlanta in 2 weeks to clinch this championship.
And in the street tuner category, McAleer and McCombie to the top by one slim point over former leader Andrew Carbonell. Well, let's get down to Jamie.
Well, Stephen McAleer, I know you're exhausted at the end of that battle with Spencer Pompelli, but now a one-point lead in the championship. Talk me through that battle.
Yeah, you know, the battle was super fun. I'd been talking all season about, you know, maybe going head-to-head with Pompelli or Foss. And, you know, I got my wish here. The result we didn't quite get. I tried super, super hard on that last lap. But, you know, the CG Wilson guys gave us a car close enough, you know, to challenge the Caymans. And our mod-space Mazda literally was fantastic the whole run. And we took four Continental tires, and the pace didn't drop off. So we're really happy, and an amazing job by this guy once again leading the race.
Congratulations, guys. Brian?
Jeff Mosing and Eric Voss, I know this is a good run for you, especially because you live here. But, Eric, for you, spectacular run. What caused the car to drop back there? You looked like you had a good one for a while.
Yeah, you know, those guys really just had us covered overall as a team. You know, Rensport 1, Spencer, those guys, and then and Steven and those guys have been really fast. You know, I just got to thank Jeff for giving me a great car. Continental tires were great. We had a couple transmission issues, but you know what? Great points. We're still in the hunt. That's all we can ask for.
Still in the hunt going to the final round. Bob?
Well, looks like one championship is all but decided, but that ST battle will go right to the finale at Road Atlanta, once again, Sunday, October 18th, 9 to 11 a.m. Eastern on FS1. A great day here at Circuit of the Americas, even though it was a warm one. It was definitely a great race to watch. We'll see you for the finale from Road Atlanta in a few weeks' time. In the meantime, for Calvin Fish, Justin Bell, Brian Till, and Jamie Howe, I'm Bob Barsha. So long from Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas.